that you are my fortress. You are my portion. You are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe to every blessing, to every promise, to every breath I take. I believe that you are provider. Oh, and you are protector. You are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way,
the way,
the truth. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I am here with you. And it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come true, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are. The truth, the life, I believe.
I hope you're like me and you believe that God is the way, the truth, and the life this morning. If you forgot that, dig out your Bible because it's in there. Won't you stand and sing with us this morning? And those of you that are willing and able, as we enter into our worship set, we're going to sing the last chord of this song together. Will you sing the way with us and let Him hear us this morning right here in Washington Courthouse, Ohio? We believe He is the way,
the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are.
Amen. This song's called We Praise You, and that's what we're here to do, isn't it? It's a great way to kick off what we're doing this morning. So let's praise Him together, all souls in the church, one big choir singing it. Here we go.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark, and it changes everything. We sing with all we are, and we claim your victory. Let it rise. Let praise arise.
Amen.
We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift Him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let faith arise.
Let it rise.
We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what heaven looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh,
we praise him this morning, don't we, church?
I love you. The moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so
Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered round him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants so that they did not bear grain. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, some multiplying 30, some 60, some 100 times." Then Jesus said, "Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear." When he was alone, the 12 and the others around him asked him about the parables. He told them, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to those on the outside everything is said in parables, so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, and ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise they might turn and be forgiven." Then Jesus said to them, "Don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? The farmer sows the word. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. Others, like seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. Still others, like seed sown among thorns, hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. Others, like seed sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it, and produce a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100 times what was sown."
Book of Nehemiah tells us that there was a great revival that happened in Israel when they began to discover the Word of God again. Book of Nehemiah also says to us something rather amazing. It says, "The joy of the Lord is our strength." Can you repeat that with me this morning? The joy of the Lord is our strength. One more time. The joy of the Lord is our strength. That's why we're singing. That's why we're praising God this morning. It's let the joy of Jesus Christ and our joy about Christ make a difference in our lives. Let's begin our time of prayer right now. Father, we are thankful. We are grateful this morning for your goodness to us. We thank you so much for the privilege of being here today. We thank you for helping us to know that you are there. Sometimes in life, Lord, we realize that we struggle to sense your presence. We know there are times when we pray and we wonder if our prayers have gotten past the ceiling of the room we're praying in. We have those times. But Father, thank you so much for letting us know that you're there. Help us to realize that there is that still small voice of your Holy Spirit which comes to us just when we need it. Help us realize we are not alone. You have never left us. You do not forsake us. You just don't do that. So help us this morning to establish that in our minds and hearts, that you are the God who is always there as we come to you. Thank you, Father, through the songs, the singing, we can sense a spirit of your presence with us. Thank you for the answers to prayer that we have sensed and caught in life. Thank you for those occasions where nature even speaks to us and helps us to realize what an amazing creative God you are. Thank you, Father, for the times when somebody has brought a witness to us that has helped us at just the right time to sense you still care for us. And thank you, Father, for your amazing word, which is nonstop reminding us you are the God who cares for your creation. You're the God who cares about the things that happen in our lives. You're the God who chooses to lift us up and not to put us down. You're the God who chooses to free us and not shackle us. Thank you, Father, for the kind of God you are. We thank you, Father, for answers to the prayers of so many of us and many of our church. You've helped us to find a new wonderful leader and family. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers for leadership. We thank you for Pastor Phil. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his experience. We thank you for his dedication. We thank you for the way he delivers truth. We thank you, Father, for all of that. So thank you for hearing and answering prayers. Father, we pray for his church, Capital City Church, as they seek a new leader. We pray that you would be with them and guide them and give them direction. Help them find just the person they need for this time. So it's a win, 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 win all the way around. Father, thank you for hearing us. Thank you for responding. be near to our friends today, our family members who are going through times of confusion and complication, times of illness and difficulty. Would you please let them know that they've not been abandoned either, by us or by you. Father, give us the light that you have from your word today. Speak to us in ways that really reach deep into our lives personally. This isn't just for somebody else. These words are for us. Help us to hear them. And Father, we pray, we realize there's so many things around the world we could be praying about. We pray for Afghanistan and the mess that's going on over there. And Lord, we realize when we think about it, you are as in love with those people as you are with us, every bit of it. They are children of your creation. You love them. Christ died for them. Be with them in their times of confusion and fear. And if we can't work out political solutions, we can't figure out how to do it from this side of things, we pray that you would help people there from your side of things. Give them strength. Give them peace. Help them to have a sense of faith and hope, which many of them already have. But bless them and help them during these complicated times, and do your miraculous helping and healing among them, we pray. Thank you for today. Thank you for each person here today. Thank you for this amazing, important time together. And we'll give you praise and thanks because the joy of you, Lord, is our strength. And a part of our joy is because you've given us Christ, in whose name we pray. And all the people said, amen. Amen. What a great word from the Lord this morning. If you have these, if you've never yet filled up, maybe you're new with us for a second or third time, we're so glad you're here today because you've become a part of the future of this church. Thank you for your importance. And if you've never filled out one of these cards, you've been here forever. We need this on our database because we're sending out a lot of information to you during these days. Pastor Phil will be doing the same thing. And so fill this out. Also, we have one more thing to fill it out for, and we'll tell you about that in just a few moments. But our head elder, our first elder, our spiritual elder, Dennis Milstead, is coming to talk to us right now. Dennis, help us out.
Good morning. It's been a great week here at Heritage. I'd like to tell you that we have hired a pastor. Amen. Can we say that with some enthusiasm? We have hired a pastor. So let me tell you a little bit about that. Last week I kind of made a mistake when I was here, and I told you we'd count the votes right after the service. And I forgot to mention there is also 7 days that he has to reply. So while my phone was exploding all day, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and partially Wednesday, of everybody, and which I am thankful for every call because that shows excitement, and I love that. But while you were doing that, we really had to wait for his answer and also respect what was going on in his church for him being able to let his people know what was happening. And we did not want his people to find out from our people. So that's kind of why if you called me and I delayed everything till Thursday and we were able to make those announcements, that's the reason why. If you haven't heard that yet, let me go back through where we spoke about the fact that I told you through 3CU we have to take the member count only, and but we wanted to hear what everybody had to say, and that's true, we did. And what we found out in that process is that we had 187 members that cast votes. Out of the 187, 176 voted yes and 11 voted no. Out of the non-members, we had 126 ballots go out. Only 114 came back, so we had 12 unaccounted for. But out of that 114, we had 110 say yes and 4 say no. So that's a 96.5% approval rate with your non-members, a 94% with our members. That was a great turnout. We were up about 160 people last week over the previous few weeks. So it was great to have that kind of turnout. Again, I just, as Dave was praying, just continue to pray for their church as well as they go through the changes and they have to move, and some of their people feel like they've lost their pastor as well. Just continue to pray for them. Some of you may have gotten the letter. I hope everybody got the letter, but it's still out there. If you didn't, you can get it, but I'm going to give you a little spoiler alert here. I'm going to read just a little bit of the last half of it for you here. And this is from Phil. As he looks to us, he says, as I look forward to joining you on October 3rd, there are several things I challenge you to consider. As I told the first service, he's challenging us already. He's not even here. That's great. I love that. So he says, reach out to those who used to come to Heritage and invite them to return. Pray that God will give him wisdom. Pray for our church board that we will have direction as we prepare to partner together. Begin to ask God to renew the burden for our community. And he says, ask God to help us to see them as he sees them. That's just phenomenally important there. And with the other part, it says, be ready to see God work in your lives and the lives of other. He said, reach out to each other, pray together, serve together, attend services and groups together. And if anything good happens, give God the praise that he richly deserves. So with that being said, he wraps up, says, thank you very much. God bless you greatly. Look forward to seeing you soon. So we've hired a pastor. That's a great thing. And I look forward to getting back to our worship this morning. I'll turn it over to them.
Morning. One more final thing, and that is that next Sunday is an exciting Sunday because we're going to be having a lot of baptisms next Sunday. People publicly professing their faith in Christ, both services, first and second service. If you plan to be baptized next Sunday, if you've indicated that, please meet with me following the service this morning, right down here in the first couple of rows, so we can get some instructions for next week. If you've been thinking about it but haven't yet decided, come on down and listen to what's happening. If you plan to get baptized, fill out one of these cards. You've never done that yet, come on down front after service. We'll get it all taken care of. It'll be a great day next week. Let's worship together again.
Well, if you came here in a good place today, God bless you. But the reality of the situation is, this many people in a room, some of us are in low places this morning. We're going to hear about that in the sermon too. But just like thousands of years ago, we have a God to rely on. And in those low times, we need to sing, yes, I will lift your name up, and continue to count our blessings. So if you're in a low place this morning, sing, yes, I will lift you up. If you're in a great place this morning, sing, yes, I will, with thanksgiving in your heart. And let's be one big church choir this morning. That's what worship is. Everybody here plays a role, and God cares about every single soul in this room today. Let's sing the verse together. I count on one thing.
I count on one thing. The same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late. Working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes.
No matter what those days bring us, we are called to praise God each and every day of our lives because he gave us life, didn't he?
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late. Working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy.
next song means a lot to me personally. I work at a juvenile residential facility called the Ranch of Opportunity, and it really magnifies how important the lives of our kids are. I mean, I'm still 23 years old, so I'm still technically a kid too, but the world we live in affects our kids, affects our people, affects what they've been through. And I'm very blessed to know the girls that I know. I'm very blessed to know the staff members that I work with. And this song is so important because they leave. They get better, and then they leave. They go right back into the world that sent them there in the first place. So it's so important that we teach our kids how to be good, godly people and how to look up when things get hard. So the bridge of this song is what I love about it. May God bless you for generations, your children and their children. So please sing this song with us and take it to heart and take it to your kids too.
No matter what puts in front of us, God never gives you more than you can handle. That's biblical, that's scriptural. And His favor will come to you and your church.
Coming and you're going and you're weeping and rejoicing.
before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, and you're coming, and you're going, and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
God to hear you this morning.
Amen.
We thank you, Father, for the blessing. Thank you, thank you. Feel free to be seated this morning. Thank you very much. Timeless old song that most of you that have been around church for a long time, you'll all know it for sure. We talk a lot about the crucifixion and what it means. Boy, it means a ton, right? But the beauty's in the end of the story, isn't it? Because if it just died and that was it, what would we be doing here, right? But he rose from the grave and he lives this morning. And he's in this place. So pray for Juan and Ryan on this one. I thank her for singing with me this morning. Such a blessing.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river. I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I know. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because
He lives, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
Thank you, Rob and Tawana. I guarantee you we're going to give you a chance to respond to that song and to the marvelous doxology that ended with amen, amen. I don't know about you, but I was ready to do something. And this morning we're going to have a chance to do that. I want you to respond to the message this morning with this powerful stuff. You know, whether it's around the campfire or at camp itself, or whether it's by the bedside or out in nature someplace, whether it is, actually on a sandy beach, or whether it's through a sermon. Everybody loves a good story, right? Don't you like stories? Storytelling is a wonderful thing. There are people that had the amazing art of storytelling back in the day, and it was just a wonderful thing. Well, I want to let you know something. We're about to hear from one of the best short story creators and tellers in all of human history. You know who it is? It's Jesus. That's exactly right. Jesus lived approximately 33 years on this planet. He had only 3 years to really express himself through public ministry. 33 and three, and yet, can you think of anybody? As you think about the life of Jesus, as you think about people today, how many musicians, how many singers, how many rock stars, how many athletes, how many politicians, how many world leaders have impacted the world over the past 2,000 years more than Jesus Christ has? The answer is nobody. When you think about the life of Jesus Christ, who was born in such an amazing way? Who lived the kind of life he lived? Who taught the kinds of things Jesus taught us? Who was ever unjustly assassinated the way he was, rose from the dead, and as he parted the clouds to leave, said, I'll be back. Who has ever done that before? Nobody. Who has ever declared themselves to be Savior and Lord? Actually, a few people have done that, but they're off base. Some have tried that. But who has ever been believable enough to be called Jesus as Lord, and it's Jesus Christ himself? And so Jesus Christ, listen, Jesus Christ is the only one in a category of one. Amen? That's the Christ we're talking about. That's the one who's teaching the lesson that we're given today. And my question is, do you know him? Do you know him? The immediate answer for most of you is, yes, I know him. But I'm asking you again, do you really know him as much as you could know him? Do you? Have you ever decided to take him seriously? And I would say, after your first answer of yes, I'm going to ask seriously enough. Is there anything else yet in your life Christ can help you with? I want you to think about that. Because this Jesus is so amazing. Christ is so astounding. There is no limit to what he can be and needs to be to each one of us. This amazing Christ. Jesus used parables. Parables are kind of a story form. Storytelling. A parable is a kind of comparison. Parable kind of is the same word as parallel, like parallel tracks. They run alongside each other. A parable is a story that is told to describe something else that's kind of like it. In this case, Jesus tells about physical things to energize spiritual realities. And so a parable is something Jesus used to teach people. The story of the Good Samaritan is a story. Parables are like the ones we're doing today. Now, a more contemporary view of parables is that they function like this. When you read a parable, as we're reading today, they tend to function like these three things in our lives that are very common. They function like a picture. You can see them happening in your mind's eye. You heard the scripture reading. You could kind of see that happening as the sower was out, the farmer was out planting seeds or tossing seeds. But next is a window. A window helps us to see through the story, past the picture, beyond it, to deeper, greater, more things. It expands our understanding. And finally, the mirror helps us to ask ourselves the question, in the story that Jesus told, where am I? How does this teaching apply to me? What difference in my life should this story make? And this morning, as we look at this story, the very last thing we're going to do is to ask ourselves the question, where are you in the story, and how should this make a difference in your life beginning today? Now, why did Jesus use parables? What's the purpose? What's the point? Why didn't he use some other mechanism? Why did he use parables? First of all, because they had wide appeal. Everybody loves a good story. And the second is, this is kind of shocking for you to hear from me, the parables actually invite us to, here's the word, think. How about that? Now, most people think that religion and Christianity is just a bunch of fluff and a bunch of emotion. And the fact is, there is tremendous emotion in our faith and our religion. We have more reason to sing, to celebrate, to clap, to do everything that it takes to be joyful, happy people. We have every reason on planet Earth to have hope because of who Christ is and what our faith means to us. Amen? But beyond just the emotional part of it is that what Jesus constantly wants us to do, to think, to figure it out. He would tell us stories and almost never finish them. When Jesus gave us teachings, he would usually leave them just a step or two short and in essence say, figure this out. Listen to me. Figure out where I'm coming from. What are you going to do with this? And so Christianity is a thinking person's religion. It is not just emotion. It's about thought and process and asking God to help us understand what he's talking about. Creation itself is so complex. Creation itself is so sophisticated. Creation itself is so massive and so microscopic that even those who refuse to believe in a creator God have come to the point, the greatest scientists on the planet who don't believe in God have come to the point where they say there's got to be, listen, intelligent design behind this. Because the fact is, evolutionary types of teaching without a creator God behind them, evolution has nothing to say to me about my value, my purpose, and system of direction in life. I get nothing that's important to me out of that understanding. Creationism, creation by God, a thoughtful, caring, considerate God behind everything gives me a reason for purpose, a reason for value. My Christian faith gives me a reason to live. All of that comes from a creator who cares for me, understands me, knows my life, and has the best for me in hand, in mind. And so Jesus says, this is a thinking thing. I want you to process it. The third reason why parables use parables is because they apply to any race, any culture, any generation. And today's parable is an agricultural. And this is a Fayette County story today, okay? This could be told in our county right here. This is an agricultural farming story. It's the kind of thing we understand in this area. National Geographic had a marvelous presentation the other night that Marlene and I watched. Basically, it was this. It made the case for how important agriculture was in feeding the world, all right? To keep human beings from starving to death, besides other forms of food, agriculture is the dominant form of feeding the human race. Isn't that amazing? Agriculture is behind the most important stuff that ever happens to us. We have food to eat. It keeps us from starving. And so the story was on agriculture and the importance of agriculture and the progress of agriculture, how to become more efficient, more effective, how to produce a better crop, as the scripture is talking about. And in the process, they said this planet can probably support feeding about 12 billion people. And they said 30 years ago, there were 7.7 billion people on the planet. And 30 years hence, now there are 9.7 billion people on the planet. So the obvious question coming is, what's going to happen when this planet exceeds 12 billion people? And they said, we have to keep getting better at how we do what we're doing with the soil, with the land. We have to get better at how we raise crops and how much we produce. And we have to explore places that have not yet been maximized, like the continent of Africa. That's amazing to me. The continent which has been halfway starving for centuries may become the food bank of the world. Isn't that amazing? And so this story, what's beautiful about this little story Jesus is telling us that we're starting with today, we'll spend a couple of weeks on it. This little story is as dramatically important and powerful to the 21st and 2nd centuries as it ever was back then. So Jesus and Jesus' deity and Jesus' brilliance and Jesus' wisdom, he tells us a story that is good for all time and for all people. That's Christ. And so he gives us this amazing story to track. And we start looking at this one today. Now, he also tells parables to challenge the closed mind and the calloused heart, as he says in Matthew chapter 13, verses 10 through 15. There's a very confusing sounding statement in this story. You may have caught it when it was being read, as I call him, Video Max. But we're going to talk about that confusing statement that Jesus makes in subsequent weeks and what he's talking about when he makes that statement. So these are some of the reasons for speaking in parables. Today's parable is especially important. Take a look at Mark chapter 4, verse 13. Take a look at this single verse and look at what Jesus says. He tells the parable to people. He paints the picture. Then he talks to the disciples by giving them the window. And he says to them, as he starts to explain the parable, don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? Do you realize what he's saying? He's saying that right here in Matthew 13, Mark 4, and Luke 8, sits one of the most important parables or stories Jesus ever told. He is saying, if you and I don't get this one, we may not get any of them. And so please have in your mind the importance, the significance, the power of this little story we're going to study for the next couple, 3 weeks. He says, if you don't get this one, you won't get any of it. This is a key core parable that Jesus told. It's all about the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? There are various ways to describe the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. It basically means God's rule, God's will, what God's want, doing things the way God calls us to do them. It's letting Jesus Christ, in our case, be Lord. And so the kingdom of God is about how we respond to God in our lives. And through the 2,000, it's 2,000 years old, this story, but it's incredibly relevant to Fayette County in the 21st century today. And it subtly hints at the amazing truth that we can change. One of the hidden little jewels in this whole story is the observation that we can change. There can be transformation in life. But here's the great key. He teaches us that how we respond to truth means everything. It isn't so much, listen carefully, this little parable begins to teach us it isn't so much what happens in life that counts nearly as much as how we respond to what happens. This powerful little story helps us figure out life at its most challenging. Let's take a look at the parable. I'm going to call it the parable of the soils. You have in your Bible the parable of the sower. I'm going to rename it just for us for the parable of the soils. It's dominantly about the soils in this passage. Mark chapter 13, Mark chapter 4, Matthew 13, Luke chapter 8. The key elements are three. First of all, there is the sower. Jesus implies that the sower is either God or himself as a storyteller. The sower could be God, it could be Jesus, it could be the Holy Spirit. In our generation, it could be the Bible itself speaking to us because the Bible is God's word to us. It could be us speaking to other people through a witness about our faith. And so the sower could be God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the Bible, or you and me. That's the sower. The second thing is the seed. The seed is the word of truth, the kingdom of God. It's the gospel, or in our case, it would be about Jesus. That's the seed as it replies to the 21st century. The third thing is the soil or the soils. And here's the key thing. It isn't just one soil type or one soil characteristic. It's four. He talks about four different soil conditions. And we're going to study the first one today. Take a look at the next ones coming up. But four amazing soil conditions. Listen to what's amazing about this. He's not talking about dirt. He's talking about human beings. The soil, in this case, the soils are human souls, human beings. He's talking about the various human conditions that we experience in our lives. So for now, let's begin with that first soil situation. In Mark chapter 4, verse 4 and verse 15, he says in verse 4, some seed fell on the path. The birds came and ate it up. In verse 15, some people are like, there it is. He's talking about people, not dirt. Some people are like the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes it away, the word that is sown in them. Back in that day, the people believed that spirits inhabited the air all over the place. There were hundreds, thousands, millions of spirits all over the place. So Jesus is saying there can be all kinds of things try to snatch your faith away from you. There are enemies out there that Satan has that can deter you from trusting in God and believing his word. There are human enemies. There are spiritual enemies, all trying to wage war against your faith in God. And then in Matthew chapter 13, verse 19, when anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes along and snatches away what is sown in his heart. I talked to so many people over the course of years who say, well, I'm not really into your thing. I'm not really into your religion, your faith. I said, well, why not? Tell me about that. And they say, well, because, you know, Jesus is no big deal. Jesus is really just one of many great teachers in the world. There's a lack of understanding there. I commonly ask, have you actually read the Bible about Jesus? Have you read what Jesus said? What do you know about Jesus? And the fact is, so many people leave the faith alone, reject the faith, reject the church, because they really don't understand what it's about. That's why the teaching and the preaching, we do this week in and week out, is to try to clarify what the Word of God says, what truth is really about. That's what we're trying to accomplish right this very second, to give you greater, better understanding so your faith will be deeper, your life will be better because of Christ in it. Luke chapter 8, verse 5. Some fell along on the path that was trampled on. Here's a new word. Luke is a medical physician. He has a big heart. Luke almost consistently tells the story of Christ in terms of human pathos and passion and compassion. Luke says in this parable that Jesus gives, he's talking about soil that has been trampled on. Do you hear the connection? He's talking about human lives that have been trampled on. He's talking about human lives that have experienced abuse and mistreatment, that have not been given the same kind of love or chances or opportunities that many others have. Luke understands that the human condition involves people's faith being affected and their unwillingness to open their lives to God because of something that somebody else has done to them. They've been victimized. So Luke brings in another amazing concept here. Then he says in verse 12 of chapter 8, those along the path hear, and the devil comes along and takes away the word from their hearts so they may not believe and be saved. Because they're discouraged, they're confused, they're hurting. They don't understand God. The only notion of God the Father they have is the one that they had at the house, and that wasn't so great sometimes. The only understanding they have of how life works are the confusing, dysfunctional ways that they've been given or shown or drug into. And so this parable talks about human beings who've experienced some of life's significant hardships, so they even have a hard time responding to God's love for them. What an amazing insight into life. He's not talking about dirt. He's not talking about soil. He's talking about human souls. So what was the problem here? The problem was this soil was not receptive. It was not receptive to the seed. It did not, could not take it in. The soil was resistant to the truth of God gaining insight into the life. And what was the reason? Why? What was the problem? The problem was it was resistant and it was not receptive because it had become hardened. It had a veneer over it. Have you ever met somebody who there's just this wall? There's this veneer that they have. They can't bother to let anybody else really get in close because it's too dangerous inside of them. I don't want you to know who I really am, what I'm really like. I don't want to be hurt again. I don't want to be thrown away again. I don't want to be insulted again. And so we keep people at a distance. We develop this toughness, this veneer. It's exactly the way he describes the soil because it's what happens to human beings. The enemies of our well-being have attacked us. We've been stepped on, abused, mistreated, deprived of the right stuff. And there were those who were enemies of God's love and grace in our lives. Has that ever happened to you? Have you ever been victimized? Have you ever experienced being treated so far different than the love of God, you can't imagine what the love of God is really like. It's hard to trust. It's hard to believe. Or some of your own attitudes, your behaviors, even your faith, your openness to God, has it been stunted? Your sense of who you are? Your sense of significance? You say, I'm full of shame. I have low self-esteem because the enemies of life have come along and stolen the stuff from you that God wants to give to you. You set yourself up for the bad guys, the birds in life. You set yourself up for Satan or other people to rob you of the things that God has for you. And it becomes a very, very vicious cycle. So what are the solutions? What helps? I talked to one of our farmers in the congregation. It was, it turned out to be Doug Miller in this case. And Doug, I said, Doug, tell me a little bit, give me a little Fayette County wisdom about this parable. He said, okay. I said, talk to me about this hard soil. He said, what do you do with hard soil? I asked him. He said, well, you break it up. Soil has to experience, listen to this, here's the word, soil has to experience brokenness. Isn't that good? Soil has to experience brokenness. So we plow it and we disc it for one specific purpose, so that the seed has the greatest possibility that it can have to have full exposure to the soil. And so sometimes our lives have become hardened, our attitudes have become hardened. We don't have great contact with God. And so sometimes things in life need to break us up, so we begin opening ourselves more to having contact with God. God wants us to have intimate, personal connection and contact with Him. And sometimes that comes through brokenness. We were listening to music last night in a concert. And the song said, sometimes it takes a mountain, sometimes a raging sea, sometimes a desert to get a hold of me. But in every situation, God's love is there for me. Then He gave us Jesus to trust and to believe. Maybe life has done that to you. Is it possible for you, whether you've been a Christian for years, to sense that there's still some broken parts and pieces in your life that need healing? Still some attitudes towards yourself that need to be repaired? Some sense of lacking significance that God wants to give you? Is it possible in your life today, in some particular area, that there needs to be a beginning of healing? You know, there are plenty of reasons why you might be resistant or reluctant to respond to God and His truth in Jesus. We've talked about people recently who prayed and prayed and prayed that their relative, their loved one, their spouse, their child would be healed. And it didn't happen, seemingly. And so the wall is up. God, if you don't care about me enough to help the ones that I love, then how can I and why should I love you? But somehow, some way, we have to understand that in the end of things, as we said last week, God's got this. Can you learn what it means to trust Him in all things and all circumstances, no matter what? This morning, I've asked Rob to come in and to join us again. And as we approach the Lord about this amazing story Jesus told, the question is, are you willing to become more responsive to God and His love and His truth? And so to give you the opportunity for that, I'm just going to join you right down where you are on the floor here. I'm going to come on down, and I'm going to ask Rob if he would just sing the song that he sang a few weeks ago, Come to Jesus. This isn't about finding first-time salvation. This is about every time in life you need it and sense the need is there. Christ is the answer. Keep coming to Him. And this morning, as we share this time together, I'm simply going to ask you this. If in your life you sense that you have experienced some of this hammering and trampling and problems and struggle in your life, it's created veneers for you. You have no real understanding of who you are in Christ. You lack a sense of importance about who you are and how you count. I want you, just as we listen to Rob sing this song and the verses, just come on up here and just stand around me. And let's have time of prayer together and let healing begin. The song we sang earlier, generation after generation after generation. You concerned about some of the generations following you, are you? I am. Is it time to pray about those generations, that their hearts be open? I think so. So this morning, while he sings, here's your opportunity just for us to let something important begin in your life, through your life, for your life, because coming to Jesus is exactly what he keeps asking us to do. So while he sings, come on up kneel, stand, and in a few moments we'll pray together. Just come up and stay here and pray together. Listen to him sing. Come on up.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your head for love's passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when we walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely, it's deep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Come to Jesus and live.
Father, what a marvelous time it is to be in church today. Thank you for every single person that I'm looking at right now, kneeling at these altars. Thank you, Father, for open hearts, for open lives, for honest young people, honest adults, people who want a sense of faith in the family, who want to make sure that every kind of healing that is needed in their lives is dealt with today. So, Father, even though many of us may be faithful followers of yours, the healing needs to continue. So today we give ourselves to you. We say, Lord Jesus, help me to understand your grace goes deep. Your forgiveness is for real. The faith that I can have can last for a lifetime and through eternity. Help me to understand what a great gift you gave us in Jesus Christ, how important Jesus Christ can be to us day in and day out. So Lord, no matter what the pain, no matter what the problems, no matter what the treatment has been over the years, help us to give over the sense of shame, the sense of anger, the struggles, the difficulties. Help us to just give it to you. It is yours. You're the one, Father, who knows how to deal with everybody else that's affected our lives. On this day, this time, in this church, in this place, August 22nd, 2021, we choose to follow Jesus Christ. We choose to come to Jesus about the issues we're dealing with right now. We choose to let our faith rise far above fear and help us to be established as people who are loved by God and who will spend the rest of our lives here figuring out what it means to love you. Thank you for each person in this place. Thank you for the ones up here at the altar. Thank you for the ones who aren't here, but they sure need the help you can offer them. Thank you, Father, for the fact you can begin to dismantle those veneers, the things that we cover up our lives with, and give us freedom. Give us help. Give us strength. Give us joy. Give us hope. And Lord, for the ones that need to be doing this right now, help us just to pray in our hearts like this. Heavenly Father, I'm here because I need you. I'm here because I want you. I'm here to thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son, who came and lived an amazing life, gave his life for my sins and the sins of the world, and is willing to receive me as one of your children. Thank you. I give myself, Father, to you freely, openly. Thank you for your forgiveness. Let me walk with you. Help me to find friends that that can support me and encourage me in the right ways in life. Help these young ladies up here who are living together right now to be each other's greatest encouragers and supporters now and for a long time to follow. May something important be happening right now as you give us strength and help than all you can give us. We declare today we are yours. We want to be followers of Christ. Help us to figure out how to do that. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for letting our past be erased. Thank you for carving out a better future for us. And help us, Father, learn what it means to not be pushed around by what happens in life, but to find strength by how we respond to what happens in life. Give us all that we need to do all of that. And we'll give you thanks and praise and appreciation from this day forward. And all of God's children said, amen. Rob, sing that chorus again for you again.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die, raise your head, for love is passing by.
Love is passing by.
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. And live. Come to Jesus. And live.
Amen. Stand together, please, this morning. Those of you that, matter of fact, some of you this morning may be great candidates for baptism, young ladies, adults. If you've made a decision in faith for Christ today, baptism will be a wonderful thing for you next week. So if you want to listen in to what we're going to talk about, all of you that plan to be baptized next week, second service, some of the first service, just walk over there and sit down in the first two rows. I'll talk to you in a few minutes about the instructions for next week. Let's make next week a week to never forget. Amen? A week to never forget, because today is a day to never forget. God bless you. Thank you. We'll talk about what you're doing here and be with us over there just a few moments. Thank you very much. You may be dismissed. Say thanks for each other for coming and showing up around here today. And let's gather up here for talks about baptism.